Is corpse going to be Marilyn Manson? Hey everyone, welcome back to the podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. I'm smoking cigarettes and drinking coffee, so it's been a morning, a great one. I actually woke up at 7, took Nimbus Kakarot out for a walk at 7:30. Then we had breakfast, then we went out again at 9. So, you know, life's pretty good today. But I felt like a mood needed to be set. But I also felt I needed to smoke a cigarette. Sometimes we enjoy things that we know are bad for us. And that is going to help us transition into today's podcast, which is sort of a continuation of last week's. But I need to set you guys up because later in the week, I have videos coming that will make much more sense if I explain these ideas to you right now. I want to talk about, thanks to a comment I got, the pondering question I've been wondering. How do we know that corpse won't be Marilyn Manson one day? How do we know that the content creators we're seeing now and connecting with aren't one day going to come out with some sort of scandal in 10 years about them, like serial raping people? Well, let's go ahead and start by answering the question that I got from a person in my comment section. I don't normally give usernames out because I don't want people to feel like I'm targeting them. Unless you're a complete asshat, then I might. But this person was very sweet, so I don't want to do that to them. It says, for context, that they deleted a previous post that I had seen and instead rephrased their question from this perspective. It says, hi, I deleted my previous comment asking about your BDSM perspective of, quote, choke me like you hate me, but you love me, end quote. That is a lyric from one of Corpse's songs. Since you did mention it briefly at the 26 mark of my last video about Corpse, about him being a monster. And then I said, they said in their comment, I would like to revise and say, I would like the, quote, treat corpse like an adult, quote, to manifest as challenging the lyricism of corpse's music. For those of you who missed last week's podcast, I had said that women, his viewers, tend to infantilize corpse, which to some large extent actually is because of his lyrics. So I find this comment very interesting. And I'll explain in a second by reading you those lyrics because we're going to have to dissect them a little bit to understand corpse a little bit better through his music only. Again, I do not watch his gaming channel stuff. I do not watch his collaborations. I know he's collabed with people. I've watched briefly a couple things here and there, but watching Among Us is just like not my thing. So I did not really do that. I just listened to his music. So and kind of stalked his Twitter a little bit, which I got some things to say about that too. So then the comment goes on to say, those lyrics don't strike me as, quote, spotlight on my choking kink, end quote. It strikes me as a toxic dom energy. It strikes me as a man in music who has influence and prestige that could end up in the future of a sexually coercing an underage fan like countless other male musicians before him, i.e. Marilyn Manson, so on and so forth. Indiana Jones is sitting to the left of me and Nimbus is sitting at the door and they're both like, so if you see them fighting during the thing, know that it's out of love. Mostly he wants to play and she doesn't want to. So we respect boundaries in this family. If my girl doesn't want to play with him, he doesn't, you know, she gonna have to, but she got to defend herself too. You know what I'm saying? Don't worry. They never get into it. Okay. This is a podcast. I'm not editing any of this. Okay. Let's see. So the quote goes on to say, I would like to see an adult corpse who takes ownership over the care and caution and consent that goes into BDSM in music and in life practice, who takes ownership of the dark trap genre of his music and influence of his music, which he did not do in the Anthony interview, and takes ownership over his mental health journey. Okay, so I'm going to try to explain why this comment was very interesting to me. Now, obviously, this isn't whatever criticism I end up holding about this comment. It isn't one about the author. Because I don't know the author, right? Oops. Okay, we're done, cigarette. Thank you for your participation. I have a second one in case I get in the mood. So, hold on. Excuse me, DBZ sip. Mm. Oh, yeah, some coffee ASMR for you. So, I pulled up the lyrics for Corpse's song. It's the E-Girls Are Ruining My Life song. Choke Me Like You Hate Me is like one of the opening lines. Now, I just want to preface this for people who don't know. Corpse is a alternative musician. I actually don't understand the genre he's supposed to be, so I have no comment on that because I know Corpse himself doesn't want to be just one thing. He wants to express himself through music, which is why like agoraphobic, and he wrote the song, and it's very different than like the E-Girl song. So many people might not know how to categorize him, but instead I just like to take Corpse as like a person, an individual. And in the lyrics, for e-girls are ruining my life, just listen to this, okay? It says, choke me like you hate me, but you love me. Low-key want to date me when you fuck me. Touch me with the lights off and my chains on. Baby, I'm not the right one you should wait on. She's a freak, little bad hoe. Gasper told me kill it. I said, let me grab my death note. She pulled me in like a lasso, saying that she knew me. I don't even know her, though. Ain't no daddy issues, then I won't even bother. She say a killer cat like Luca Magnotta. He's a serial killer. Killed people. Real bad bitch, pussy bald like Saitama, which is like One Punch Man. They used to hate me, now they want me. Bitch, I feel like I'm Gaara, which is either a reference again to One Punch Man or to Naruto. We're not sure, because apparently there's characters with both those names, and both of those characters have am I bad guy or good guy complexes. I'm not sure which one he means. So sometimes I imagine both. Okay, listen to this. Okay. Okay. So she says, girl, you're fucking with the wrong one. Fuck his team. Fuck your clique. Bitch, I'm on one. Fuck your stream. Fuck your clip. You ain't saw one. Got your bitch on my dick like she want one. She got death notes, death souls, split eye. Now, this isn't, this part isn't Corpse's lyrics. This is this person that he did the song with. But think I fell in love when she grabbed me by the neck, though. All through the night, colder than ice. Man, I swear these goth girls are really trying to fuck up my life. Jesus Christ. Okay, so this is just like, stay with me here. This song is very interesting to me because he's saying choke me like you hate me. He's saying his chains are on, but then the lyrics do kind of switch where it's like they both have the power. He's saying don't fuck with me, but at the same time, she's want me. And at the same time, he's acknowledging he's messing with people with daddy issues, which is like women can be fucked up, you know, and women, men who are fucked up often attract each other for many reasons. But it's sort of different if you're both aware that you're fucked up, because then it's a game of power. It's a power exchange that happens naturally outside of BDSM. But in these lyrics alone, there is a story that's being told about this constant power dynamic between the two of them. It's not like he doesn't know who she is and she doesn't know who he is. And at the same time, he's the one with the chains on, which is interesting. And it's him expressing his sort of struggle. Now, Marilyn Manson and Corpse are sort of really, I think, good examples of things that look the same, might sound the same to people, but are not the same. And what I mean by that is, again, if you grew up like I did in the 90s and 2000s, you remember your mother protesting Marilyn Manson for being disrespectful towards the religious or abusive towards women. Conservative women were calling out Eminem before progressive women even were born. Like, this is the thing I don't think young people understand, is that Marilyn Manson's scandal right now is so not interesting to anyone who grew up conservative. At least if you grew up in my communities, like, there's actually a bunch of Catholic channels I follow because I grew up Catholic, and though I don't believe in God now, I like to check up on my homies. I had a really good experience in the Catholic Church. I became an atheist later on because I don't believe in the existence of a higher power, but I didn't ever have an issue with anyone I ever met in the church. We were really lucky. We belong to really beautiful parts of the church, a bunch of theologians and thinkers and debaters. I grew up with a lot of really prominent Catholics in my life, and we used to sit around the table and just debate the existence of God or other religions or anything else. And I forget that people don't always have that experience. Like, we were really lucky. We went to nun camp and priest camp and all of these good things. And none of my siblings, none of us 10, were ever molested or hurt by people in the church. So for me, the church is really positive. Okay, so with all of that said, and again, see, even the church, some people might say automatically abusive, some people might have good memories, we are all experiencing these things differently. So the Catholic Church had, not the Catholic Church, sorry, there are Catholic channels on YouTube that actually covered Marilyn Manson. And they were like, why no one is surprised in the Catholic Church? And it's, again, when we see the Catholic Church, I'm not meaning the church right now, like the Vatican, I mean like the people. If you were in prominent literature-based, philosophy-based, theologian-based communities in Catholicism, you knew we were dissecting Marilyn Manson back then. Now, of course, I was a rebellious teen back then, listening to Marilyn Manson lightly and loving him because of his rebellion. And I said, well, at least he's honest with how horrible of a person he is. Because Brittany values, I value more than anything, a person being honest with who they are versus in denial. Because again, if we don't know who we are, we can't communicate it. We'll always give a false idea of who we are to the world. And so we have to be very careful of that. I think the difference between Marilyn Manson and Corpse is that one went down the path of self-loathing and monstrous behavior to the point of just being the monster. But I think on the more extreme scale, versus Corpse is somebody who's playing with the idea of being the monster, but is doing it in the lighter part of the scale. So monsterism in humans is a spectrum like anything else. So you can have like the emo kids, the depressed kids, the cutters, the people who have toxic codependent relationships with their partners at 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. And these people aren't evil, malicious monsters. They're people who are dealing with trauma, and so they love through trauma. And then on the other side of the spectrum, there's people like a Marilyn Manson, who used and abused his power, but also had a really disgusting childhood and hard life. I think people really forget that trauma comes from a place. And so the difference between how we decide who gets our empathy or sympathy is going to be very subjective to the individual. There are people who dated Marilyn Manson who didn't have a bad relationship with him. And I think those relationships have to be taken into account, because a person isn't all bad. And so we have to ask ourselves, what was the difference between when Marilyn was dating this person and that person? Was it years, time, recovery? Had he been on drugs, off drugs? Was he in the height of his career, the low of his career? What were these experiences like? And then you have to take someone like Corpse and wonder, when examining his lyrics, is he trying to tell us something? Well, and agoraphobia, and there's these lyrics where he's telling you he hates himself. He feels bad. He's alone. He feels alienated. In his music, he talks about he's reaching out. But the problem is the people who reach for him are not people who are also healthy. They're people who want to save him, change him, be their mother. Like, these are not healthy things. And again, this is the trials and tribulations of not only being a young person, he's in his early 20s, but being a famous person, being an anonymous person, being a person who can't really say what they feel, or maybe says things to feel, because in the moment he feels them, but it isn't reasonable. I look at Corpse as a person on a journey, and I look at Marilyn Manson as a man who's now finishing the first half of his journey and has to reflect on the next half of it. These things have been different because the actions have been different. I don't know that Corpse is BDSM. I can assume, but I also know a lot of people on the internet who dress in BDSM and appropriate the culture but are not BDSM. So for me, I never assume anyone's BDSM unless they literally tell me, and then they almost have to prove it to me. Because I've met a lot of YouTubers who are like, I'm BDSM. And then when we went to the dungeon, did not know anything about dungeon protocol. Literally, like, I remember I went with this prominent YouTuber who, again, was a feminist, totally hypocritical, somebody who, like, is definitely loved by VidCon, and somebody who talks about how consent matters, but then needs to be high to be a submissive because she doesn't want to do it sober because she can't consent sober. She needs to be high to feel encouraged. And I'm like, I can't believe these people. And then we go to the dungeon and they're like, please no smoking. And what does she do? She fucking just like sits there and vapes, and everyone's just like, and I'm looking at her like, my bro, what are you doing? Like, obviously you've never been to a dungeon. And like, you keep saying you've been to dungeons, but like no one's fucking seen you at a dungeon. So it's like, you know what I mean? These people exist. So for me, I need to hyper vet people before I believe that they're in the lifestyle. The other thing that happens in Corpse's lyrics that I think is very interesting is that he doesn't want to be a role model. And I actually think that's key. I think people who want to be role models make me uncomfortable, because all I'm thinking is, why? I don't want to be a role model. I did at a time because I thought I was like gonna save everyone. And now I'm like, nah, 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 nah. No, 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 no. So Corpse has in his one of his songs, I don't want to be your role model. Like, he just wants to fucking make music and express himself. So when we're examining who's dangerous and who's not and who's going to be, how do we come, you know, to these conclusions while being fair through the process? Well, it's an individual basis, individual by individual basis. In the comment she wrote, or they wrote, I don't even know what their gender is, but they wrote, I just want to like pull it up here. This is my favorite part of my job, by the way. This is literally my favorite part of my job, is trying to dissect and figure out why people come to the conclusions they do and why their brain gives them these reassurances like this. Okay. It says, I would like to treat Corpse like an adult to manifest challenging the lyricism of Corpse's music. I do treat Corpse as an adult, adult on a journey, an adult who's only asking for so much responsibility. He didn't ask to become this famous. He wasn't. We still don't understand the phenomenon of him becoming this famous. And so we have to understand that, like, as a small YouTuber myself, like, I don't ever want to become as famous as Corpse, ever. I, like, a million subs, fine. 5 million, maybe. But I never, never want to even get there if I don't have to. If I can make a living never getting there, I would be happy, because I value my privacy. And that's the problem. How do you do a job that you love so much that always is at risk of putting you in a major public eye? I mean, Corpse's emoji was in New York, the Times Square, New York. And it's just like, holy fucking shit. Like, that stuff makes me feel... like, that gives me like a mini panic attack in my head where I'm like, oh my God, I would die if like this many people were paying attention to me. And that's the thing, is what makes a person like Marilyn Manson be Marilyn Manson? You'll notice the distinct difference sort of between Marilyn Manson and Corpse is that Corpse isn't quite looking for the fame of himself, but Marilyn was out there pissing people off on purpose to get attention. I do think it takes a very special kind of human, and I don't mean special in a good way or bad way, but a different kind of human to want to be in the eye of the public. I remember when I was younger and I would watch Marilyn Manson on Bill Maher or any of these talk shows where they would discuss ideas, and it was clear he had a thought process. It was also clear that he didn't see his life. It was clear that he was living his life. I think people romanticize struggle because they think it's easy. No matter if it's like black struggle or hair struggle or gender struggle or drug struggle or sex struggle, we romanticize it because we think it's easy. But when you live it, you tend to understand the loopholes. Like, as a person myself who's dabbled in a lot of these really dangerous communities, and I don't mean BDSM because that was like one of the more safer communities, but still dangerous, right? Drug parties and hanging out and with people who came from abusive backgrounds and dealing with trauma and having sex with people who had daddy issues and mommy's issues, myself included. Like, you really start to realize that trauma fucks you up. And so when you're involving yourself with people with trauma, you can't just, you have to be aware of what you're actually signing up for. And I think that's the issue, is that people think, for whatever reason, that the monster is going to choose and pick them to be the one they don't fuck with. It's like the Ted Bundy obsession. It's like the Columbine shooter obsession. Why do these people have fans? I think it's severe, fucked up mental illness. But why do people love Marilyn Manson and Corpse? Because they're still pretty fucking human. Not that Ted Bundy isn't human. He's very much human. But he's almost unrecognizable to the point where people sort of see him like a monster, which is interesting because, again, we don't want to create a false facade in our brains that humans aren't monsters or monsters aren't humans or that monsters and humans are. We just want to be self-aware that whatever language you're using, it doesn't really matter. Whatever language you're using, as long as your most real brain reminds you, your most real thought is this is a human and humans can be dangerous, I think you'll be fine. But instead, what our brain does is, humans can be dangerous, but not this human, because I would never interact with a dangerous human. Versus when I was younger, I knew people were dangerous and I still chose to interact to some extent because of the circumstance, or I didn't know how to handle it, or is outside of my understanding, or maybe sometimes it was within my understanding. I try to equally own my actions and to be aware of where I was naive so I can get better. Because for the future, I would like all of my actions to be really thought out. So when someone comes to me and says something that tells me who they are, I should listen to them. So Marilyn Manson is telling us who he is. And I do think Corpse is telling us who he is. They're very different people who look the same, but are on different parts of the spectrum. So they look the same because they live in the same spectrum, right? But they're different sides of it. So they're very, very different people at the end of the day. I see Corpse as a switch or a bottom. I honestly don't even know his orientation. I don't know if he's bisexual or gay. I don't know if he's straight. But I know that Corpse, if I was in a room with Corpse, I would want to top him. Like, as a BDSMer, as a woman who's a switch, I would assume our energy would be that I would move into top space. But that's because I think from my understanding of where Corpse is on his journey, he might be seeking that sort of interaction. I could be wrong. He could end up being a dominant that I don't understand. That certainly seems to be the fantasy of a lot of his viewers, is that he's the dominant they're going to take care of, which is funny to me. It's not too shocking, because like that can happen. It's just, it's interesting. So, okay, stay with me here. So, but Marilyn Manson, if I was in a room with Marilyn Manson, I would know that if I play with him, I would be trying to top him from the bottom. I would brat with him. And I also know that I wouldn't respect him through the scene. And I think that's kind of key, is that I do respect Corpse as a person. I have no reason not to. But with Marilyn Manson, I wouldn't have a respect with him that I think is important when you're being intimate, even in BDSM. And I wouldn't feel afraid of him because I would orchestrate a situation where there were, like, I don't know if you guys know this, but when I do a scene, I make my emergency calls. I have people on call. One time I did a scene with somebody where it was going to be life-threatening. And so we had our friends on call. You know what I mean? Or if you're doing a solo scene, it's good to have your friends on call. Hey, if I don't call you in 20 minutes, just give me a call. If I don't answer, come check on me. I might be dead. I call my sister usually before I do BDSM and I say, hey girl, I'm going to do something crazy and I need you to just be aware. Like, don't let mom and dad sue my friends. You know, everyone be chill, because I vet my people. Whether or not I take the risk of dying at the hands of somebody that might be sloppy with their work, that's on me, because I'm smart and I'm educated. If you are not smart and you are not educated, I'm telling you right now, stop what you're doing. Stop what you're doing and make a decision about your future. Are you going to engage before you can guarantee that the person you're sleeping with or doing BDSM with or doing whatever with isn't going to rape or kill you? Are you 100% confident on that? If you are not, why are you engaging when you're in a position of power to literally walk away? It's like this comment I got years ago. She writes me and she goes, hey, Brittany, there's a guy who's offering me like all the weed I can smoke, like a servant position at his house to be a slave, BDSM slave. And right now I'm living with my shitty parents. I don't like my life. I'm in debt. I think I might do this. And I was like, I'm sorry. Do you know this man? What is going on, girl? You're going to get on a plane and fly to a man's house you've never been to, never vetted, never known, and just like assume you're going to come back alive? Like, girl. And then she wrote me. She's like, you're right. What am I thinking? I was like, I don't know. What are you thinking? Tell me, what are you thinking? And I can only come to this conclusion after over a decade on this internet, after talking to thousands of thousands of thousands of people. This is the conclusion I've come to. People do not have parents telling them the world is dangerous. Because let me tell you, boo, all of my friends, all my homies, everyone I knew and I grew up with, we were so fucking aware that the world was dangerous. Like, we were just told and reminded constantly, the world is dangerous, so be careful when you're running around the neighborhood. And then our parents would let us. Our parents would tell us how dangerous the world was. And then they would let us run around for hours on end and come back whenever, you know, 4 hours, 5 hours later. Because humans are smart, and children are especially very, very smart. And children know when they're, when they feel icky, if they know what to look for. And I don't understand how these women got with Marilyn Manson and did not know it was going to go that way, right? Then I have to give them the benefit of the doubt and assume they're not liars, because these women were traumatized. And so I have to come to the conclusion that we are not giving people the right tools. So this commenter that said, those lyrics don't strike me as spotlight on my choking kink. It strikes me as a toxic dom energy. This is bias. There's nothing in Corpse's lyrics or Corpse's image that says he's even a dom. But because you have a man talking about choking, the automatic assumption of the brain, especially with everything we've been hearing, and they even mentioned other men in this in these industries coercing underage fans, right? This is a stereotype that is now being pushed, that men who struggle with trauma might be predators. Once again, devaluing the struggle of a man, and once again, dehumanizing people. We need to remember that trauma is universal. No matter your gender, no matter your background, no matter who you are, you may experience it at one point in your life. Some people won't, but a lot of people do. And it makes me sad, because as a teenage girl, I really did spend my time hoping that these band guys or these people would connect with me because I love their art. As I got older, of course, I understood that sometimes artists are better than their are worse than their art. Like, sometimes their art transcends the artist. Sometimes it's an objectification to assume these artists would connect with you. I definitely know that because I'm a content creator and I meet people all the time who say to me, we'd be great soulmates. We'd be best friends. We should get together. And I'm like, what are you seeing? Because you have to assume I'm not showing you 90% of my life. So can you really say that we're meant to be together if you don't know most of my life? And because I live behind the camera and in front of it, I know the inner workings of a lot of YouTubers, and their psychology is constantly in panic that somebody is going to not understand them and cancel them. That somebody is going to say they love them, but need them for their money and their clout. That they are going to accidentally take advantage of somebody that they finally feel connected to. Because in the real world, when you're not a public figure, most of the people I meet are doing things that people want to hold people accountable for, but we're not. Because we understand the nuance of how these things happen. We all have an abusive person in our life. We all have a relative that is a narcissist. We all have somebody in our life that has impacted our family in a negative way, and we've all had to learn to deal with those people. It is valid to both kick that person out of your life and to try to help them. It is valid to experience that moment of like how you really feel and then to do something reasonable after. It is also incredibly likely that you will take on this trauma and end up hurting other people. I think we need to find a good balance between understanding that not all victims become predators, but a lot of predators have been victims. And that's a very hard thing to process. Because I myself, when I was undiagnosed with borderline, would lash out at people, would get triggered at parties, have panic attacks in public. And regardless of the fact that I was hurting myself most of the time, I was still hurting the people around me. When we talk about suicide, when we talk about struggle, this hurts people. But at the same time, we need to be able to reach out. So we need to reach out appropriately. I think asking for help appropriately is where we all struggle. Everyone, men and women. I hear a cry for help in Corpse's lyrics, but I also respect him enough to make sure that when he's ready, he'll ask for help in an appropriate way. It is inappropriate to ask for help through art, because art is also something that you need to create to heal. So you can't stop making the art, right? Necessarily, but you don't always need to be calling for help with each piece. Sometimes you can ask for help from the universe. It's not always from your neighbor. And I think figuring out those differences is difficult, right? All right, let's take a short break. I'm going to grab another cigarette and some water, and we'll continue forward. So late at night when I'm, you know, fucking stoned as shit, I go and I watch like a bunch of anime, of course. Guys, I just finished Fruits Basket again. Because, you know, season 3 is coming up. Oh, my God. I cannot explain to you how much I love that series. Like, that and Tokyo Ghoul, like, have to be one of my favorite series about resilience and about trauma and about overcoming. Holy fucking shit. Another reason Corpse probably loves Tokyo Ghoul is the relationship with his mother. Because Corpse has quite a relationship with his mother, which is interesting. Again, all of these things make sense. People really do tell you who they are. And it's pretty simple. Of course, we relate to the art that we do because we feel like that inside sometimes. Okay. So I write myself notes. And when I'm doing these things, I text myself. And some of these texts the next day are so fucking funny. Like, they're so fucking funny. Okay. So here are some notes, because I got some good ones. I've got some videos coming. Okay. So I wrote some notes. To be young and innocent is to know, it is like sort of to not know what's going to happen next and to enjoy the journey, right? But when you're old and you've lived a life, and I don't even mean in age, I just mean life experience, you know what's coming. Like, you meet those people who are like, I don't know if this person likes me. And I'm like, you're an adult. How do you not know? And what I realized after 15 years of information, I made a podcast about this a few podcasts ago. What I realized I hadn't understood was that people didn't learn the skill of like figuring out other people as they got older. They stayed a teenager. And Fruits Basket, when I watched it originally in 2019, and I was going through everything with my stalker and everything was just so horrible, I identified with the three kids. I identified with the three main storytellers, like the protagonists. And then I realized as I rewatched it recently, oh, I identify with the older kids, like the adults, the 28-year-olds, the ones who can like house the kids and pay their bills. And it was interesting for me. It was like, oh, cool. Okay, great. Like, I am on the next stage of my life. I knew I was, but it was nice to kind of see it in fiction. So you have to remember, from my perspective, I see Corpse as not a child, because that sounds condescending, but not where I am, because I could manipulate him. I am smart enough to absolutely manipulate someone like Corpse and where he is in his life. I don't think I can manipulate Marilyn Manson. I think where Marilyn Manson is in his life is too aware of his actions to be manipulated. And that doesn't have to be, that doesn't mean anything to, that doesn't have anything to do with bad person, good person. What it has to do with is awareness of humanity in general. Same with Eminem. My mom tried to cancel Eminem when I was a kid because he was offensive to people and women. And now the feminist, progressive, like whatever people are like, we have to cancel Eminem because he promotes domestic abuse. As he makes a song with a domestic abuse survivor called Rihanna. I didn't see y'all trying to cancel the queen because you're stupid. And like, you're dumb in the same way that my mom was dumb in the 90s. You guys think you know what you're saying, but you have no fucking clue because you obviously have either gone through this but didn't process it correctly or didn't grow up enough to know, yeah, toxic people get into toxic relationships and then they fuck each other over. If you listen to that song Eminem and Rihanna did, Love the Way You Lie, and you think like Megan Fox is the literal victim in this story and Dominic, whatever his name is, isn't. And you guys, like, don't understand. They're both equally toxic, equally the victims, equally pieces of shit. Then you're not understanding that toxic... Oh, I want to keep smoking this, but I want to talk to you. Okay. Anyways, you have to understand, right? Toxic relationships are toxic relationships. So to be young and naive is to think that love fixes everything or to think that love can be toxic, right? To be young and naive is to think that, oh, if I'm in a toxic relationship and I know it, I'll just get out. Because you can't do that either, right? But you got to own that you stayed in. You can't just make it about that person who hurt you. Because you staying there is you hurting yourself. So own up to the fact that we are all responsible for how we abuse ourselves. Like, just because you touch the hot stove, right? Doesn't mean the stove is the predator alone. You touch the fucking stove. You know what I mean? Okay. Feel your feelings. Corpse and Marilyn Manson, they're feeling their fucking feelings, my bros. Listen to their lyrics, read their books or Marilyn's book, you know, participate in their world and you'll understand they are telling you some fucking stories. I just think that to the untrained ear, they sound the same, but they're very different stories. Okay. So. Okay. It says, I wrote a note that said, it can be hard trying to keep someone safe. We had to send in the kid. The adult had to stand back. So there's a scene in Fruits Basket. Okay, and forgive me, but you know, even with animes I love, I don't memorize anyone's names really. So Akito, who's my, I got a video about Akito coming, who's like the narcissist, right? Who's actually a metaphor for God because he's a god in the story. And he's like obsessed with his creations, his connections. Well, there's a scene where he's attacking the main protagonist and one of the children comes out to defend her. And it makes Akito hesitate. And what's interesting is that behind the curtain in the scene is the adults in the room saying, or the other teenagers, depending on who's viewing it, saying, see, they knew they could handle it. Sometimes in situations, the kids have to be sent in because in some cultures, the kids are just as much of an adult as other people. The reason I love Fruits Basket is because it really represents, it's a good metaphor for people like me who grew up. Yes, I got to be a kid, but I also had to be grown up pretty quickly in my household. And that's just life. Some of us have to grow up really fast in our trauma because it's necessary for survival. And then we realize everyone around us is equally a victim to some sort of mishandling of their existence. And so I think that's why empathy is found fairly strongly amongst trauma victims. But also then you get the narcissists and people who are abusive. And so you have to really be careful about how to navigate those things. I think sometimes adults will convey through childlike themes these really scary ideas and people feel very afraid about it because we think we're turning children into adults, but I think it's really adults turning themselves into children to better process their life. I think in many ways, like I always say, you know, Corpse wears like you know, nail polish and hoodies, and like he'll always look like a kid to a real adult. I'll always look like a kid to a real adult. But there comes a point where your life is really lived like an adult. Like the other day, I had something go wrong in the house. My roof exploded for the second time because of rain. I had to call a guy to come fix it. I have to do the things that my parents would have done for me, like change the windshield wipers on my car. Or like, I know adults who have never taken their car in to get their tires changed because their mom and dad always do it. Like, I am an adult. I have a house. I have my brothers who, when they need a place to stay, they can come live with me. I've got three brothers right now who are like, hey, can I come stay with you? Yeah, sure. They're not a burden to me. You know, I'm not asking them to pay rent. I'm asking them just to keep the house clean. I already live here. You know, I don't need them to pay rent because I already pay rent. But it is a difference between younger Brittany when I was struggling. Like, I would have been like, cool, can you help me with rent? That'd be so cool. But now, you know, that's not what I'm looking for from them. And that's what I mean when I say there's been a difference of change. And sometimes as the older sibling and the third oldest and the mom figure in the family other than my mother, it is clear that my siblings, when they come to me, they're coming to me as the older person in a lot of ways. And then sometimes I even come to them for advice because we have a mutual respect for each other. But we're all on a journey. I see my siblings and I look at them and I'm like, please don't make the mistakes I made. And they look at me and they very calmly say, oh, but I have to make them. You know I do. And I'm like, God damn it, I know. I know that you have to go and make these mistakes because I had to go and make these mistakes. But then I have other siblings who just observe and they're like, fuck no, I'm not doing any of that shit. You know, there's been a lot of talk about why is there drug use and sex use in these like relationships, these power dynamics? Why is there so much abuse and like blah, 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 blah? It's like the conservative parents said, right? Conservative women were already saying women should not go to parties, not put themselves in positions to be threatened. Men are dangerous. And all these sex positive feminists were like, stop it. Sex is great. Women want sex. And now the same sex positive feminists are saying these parties are dangerous. And it's like, guys, humans are dangerous. Humans are dangerous. Humans are dangerous. Humans are dangerous. Humans are also safe. Humans are also safe. Humans are also safe. Stop fucking with the dangerous ones. Ooh, but you want to because it's fucking shiny and you want to touch it and see what happens. Or you're hoping that for some reason you're the goddess amongst goddesses and you will change the heart of the monster. Please keep in mind, if you watch Fruits Basket, please keep in mind that these men who are struggling in the story, and then the main protagonist who's a girl who's trying to comfort them through their process, right? I can hear the feminist voices going, see women cleaning up the mess of men over again. And then I hear men who are anti-feminist saying, see, when men are vulnerable, women call them weak. Guys, in the story, the two men who are, or the many men in the Soma family who are struggling, are good people in their foundation. You might not think so, but God, what is your fucking perfectionist idea of a good person if you think the Soma family isn't good? And then Akito is obviously the villain, but Akito themselves is a victim. So you're given an opportunity through this anime to observe what abuse, toxicity, codependency, and obviously love does to a family unit when they love somebody who is a monster. So when I look at Corpse, he's not a bad person. He doesn't done anything to make him a bad person. So I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt and embrace him as a human who's going through a journey. Marilyn Manson has done the things that's too far. Now, I personally think this needs to be settled between him and his victims or him and his old partners, which often I believe means separation of interaction. I don't think the law is always where we need to go, because I believe that most of these situations happened with two consenting adults who had a moment together that did not go the way that one of the parties thought it was going to go, or maybe they thought about it in the aftermath. But I personally don't really understand all of the nuances in this case. So I'm not speaking for every situation, what happened with Marilyn Manson. But if we were being honest with how we're observing, especially like adult relationships or like how these love relationships happen, they happen through trauma, and trauma will breed toxicity. And it depends on how those people want to handle it. Because you guys know there are stories out there of people rising above it together or people crushing down together. I just don't think I am the all-knowing, sane God that can come on this channel and say that this is what they should do. All I know is that whatever they should do, the public shouldn't have an opinion on it. Not in the way that we do. Same with the David Dobrik situation. Same with anything where there's something that happens when relationships are different than yours that you might not understand. Even observing the David Dobrik situation, it is completely clear that people do not understand a lot of what's going on here. And it's kind of interesting to see. Because I'm seeing it from both sides, where I've been a party girl and I've been an antisocial girl. So I've been the people who don't go out and I've been the people who go out. And I'm telling you, these are two different kinds of people. And when we interact, always makes a mess. Always. And whether or not you want to embrace the mess or claim abuse or feel abused, maybe you were abused, maybe there was rape. All I know is that this is the same thing I'm seeing in culture right now, which is I love America, but we're diverse. So when we communicate with each other, we move with our bias, right? Like this open comment I opened with was an assumption that Corpse was a dom. I don't know that. Based off of his lyrics, he sounds like a bottom to me. You know what I mean? He wants the chains. So it's very interesting that when we observe people, we only can observe with the information we know. Let me see. This is for the next video. Okay. I wrote down Corpse. I wrote, my note says, Corpse hates himself. When you hate yourself, you either bottle inside or lash out at others. Both are real and both are pretty standard ways of existing when you're in that headspace. So Corpse hates himself, so he internalizes it. Marilyn Manson hates himself, so he lashes out. We forgive the people who lash inward because they're not hurting other people. And then we hold other people accountable, hopefully. I think both are equal. I think some of it's better. Like I think it's equal in terms of its damage to the individual. But yes, Marilyn Manson obviously needs to be held more accountable because he is affecting other people. But again, only those people he impacted. I don't think Marilyn Manson has impacted millions of fans. Just because the guy you idolized wasn't a perfect person, that's on you, not him. Like, celebrities are not obligated to make people put them on a pedestal. Like, some celebrities love it, but a lot of people like Corpse, they're just trying to feel their music and their art, and people automatically put them on a pedestal. Which is why when you saw when David Dobrik collapsed on YouTube, Twitter was abuzz with not saying Markiplier is a perfect person, because we don't know that. And I'm trying to tell you right now, when Corpse says, I don't want to be your role model, he is letting you know he will disappoint you. And I respect that man. That is something I can respect, because it does take a certain kind of person to think that they are so good that they could be a all-around good role model for someone. Maybe you're just a role model when it comes to good eating or good hair care or good spiritual health, you know? But the idea that you'd be perfect all around is just so young and naive, right? Okay, so to be young, there's a quote in Fruits Basket where they go, oh, to be young like you people again, clumsy, making your way through life. When you're young, you're allowed to fuck up your way through life. There really should be a forgiveness leeway. But because the age gaps are getting weirder, and because men aren't identifying as men till they're 35 and women until they're older, it's like we are staying children longer. So our parents' generation, my parents' generation, where they were already established and moving on with their life and had kids by 30, I'm not even married or have kids. I'm trying to own a house right now. I'm trying to do the basics, right? And that's the thing, is like we're not understanding how the psychology has been impacted by the internet and by a lack of reading and a lack of education. Like, America is like an adolescent teen. As a country, we're definitely a Paul brother. Like, you know what I'm saying? We are amazing and wonderful, and we've done really great things, and we've defied every sense of reasonable logic as a small country. But we're also a mess because we're still learning and we're new, and we are on a technical historical pathway to the end of us to a large extent. And I'm not even mad about any of this. This is the circle of life. Things happen. People move on. But we are not special. And yet our individuality is the most amazing and beautiful thing we've ever get to experience. So in some ways, you need to accept that, like, we are not exempt from being an animal species that has evolved over time. And at the same time, you must hold the responsibility and honor of being an existing animal species on a planet evolving over time. What I'm trying to say, and what I hope I've said throughout this podcast, is that Corpse and Marilyn Manson are on a spectrum, both on completely different ends, but both struggling, both calling for help, both people who have probably impacted people in negative and positive ways throughout their life. And the way for us, okay, to understand what we're observing, we have to be able to know culture. We have to be able to say, like, my mother will see Corpse and automatically think Satan. My dad saw a Billie Eilish video and he was like, Betsy, what is this? Is this, why are you calling Satan into your life? And I didn't blame them. They're disturbing images. If you looked at it and you had no idea who Billie Eilish was, you'd be like, oh, this girl for sure worships Satan. Satan for sure. And that's the thing. We think, oh, people should know better. But then I look at you and I see the way you react to things and I think, shouldn't you know better? Why should you know better? Because I'm assuming you've done the same work I have, which is arrogant of me, which is narcissistic to some extent, to think, well, you should know better. Why should you know better? Why do we say things like adults should know better? But then when we say it towards women who go to parties where everyone knows statistically you're going to get raped, they shouldn't know better. Or if a man drives drunk, he's a predator. But if a woman has sex drunk, she's a victim. It's like, what does any of this mean? What does any of this mean if you cannot be consistent? And yes, their life will have tiny contradictions, but there must be a consistency at least. And maybe it's just because we're wording it incorrectly. I don't think if you're drunk, it's automatically not consent, because I've had drunk sex and it's been fine. I've also been raped while drunk, which was different. These things are the same physical interaction, but completely different mental context. And what I'm trying to say is, y'all are so focused on what's physically happening, you don't give a fuck what's happening in the mental capacity. Mentally, things can be completely different than what you're seeing. I used to be at the BDSM dungeon, and I'm a masochist and an edge player. And I remember a woman after a scene I did came up to me and she was like, hey, I just wanted to check in with you and make sure you were okay. And I said, what do you mean? And she goes, well, it looked like you were in pain. And I was like, yeah, bitch, I'm a masochist and I just got beat fucking for an hour. What are you talking about? And I didn't say it like that. I was like, oh, because I understood where she was coming from, was she didn't know what to do with this information. And that's why I am a little gatekeepy when it comes to BDSM, because if she was trained in or had a mentor or at least did some studying, she would know she was about to see that stuff. And it's interesting because in some ways my women brain goes, oh, she's just a woman reaching out for a woman and making sure we're good, which is also good, right? But also annoying. Like, it's both. It's also good she reached out, and also annoying because she's insinuating that I'm stupid and in a public space don't know that I'm consenting to being beaten in front of 100 people. It's like both of these things and all of these things are true and not true, but they're things that we're feeling or thinking or observing. And so I thought that was an interesting idea, that somebody could see Corpse and see him as a dominant. So then I have to ask all the Corpse fans in my audience, do you think Corpse is a dom? Because I for sure think he's a switch at maybe, but definitely screaming for some bottom energy right now, which I respect, you know, especially as a switchy woman. Like, I really respect consensual, intimate, and meaningful relationships with the people in my life. At this stage in my life, I'm a little too old to be doing one night stands and more interested in what are you going to get out of this? I remember a homie called me and asked me to do a BDSM demonstration with him. And I asked him, like, what do you want from this? And he said, I just want to feel it, like get an idea for it. So we did a little scene where he got an idea for it. But he could tell after, he's like, yeah, it's not really my thing. And I'm like, good, I'm glad you tried it. But if somebody came to me, like, especially in a top space perspective, I try really hard to make sure that the people who want to interact with me, I always say why. I want them to know what they're looking for, even if it's just an idea, because this will set the mood and the tone for our interactions. And I'm a person who is an edge player. I do things, I want to do things in my scenes that I will never say out loud, because if you live in the world of BDSM, you know that all of it is considered assault. Even spitting on someone's assault. And girl, I'll tell you right now, I done been spit on. And it's one of those things, right, where it is very dangerous for a top or a dom to interact with these people, because you are always the one at fault. Toxic submissives exist in the community. I have definitely seen them and had to interact with them. I've seen people be slandered and communities be thrown into a loop because somebody accuses someone of something that is just so fucking not true. But again, people want to believe the person who cries wolf, which is why I make people, even victims, prove themselves. But I also know that I try to fight my bias so hard. Meaning, when I see an Eminem or a Marilyn Manson or a corpse, I don't automatically assume they're bad people. I don't automatically assume they're good people. I ask them who they are, and then I pay attention to their actions. I haven't always been as good deciphering. I've had to learn the hard way, and I've been blessed because of those lessons. Because I've been hurt and taken accountability for how I've interacted with those people, I'm now able to feel pretty damn confident that I'm not going to crucify an innocent person and I'm not going to let a bad person get away with anything because I'm going to be able to sit down and talk to them and understand it. But you need that opportunity. I cannot tell you by watching someone's YouTube videos, for the most part, who they are in their inner workings because I don't know these people. Just like I know people write me all the time trying to guess what I'm doing or who I am, and they're so completely off. It's very interesting. It is a very big phenomenon that I think only content creators and people who are in a position of power understand to some extent. The reason I don't trust people in power who always talk woke talk or the stereotype of like the white feminist man is because anyone who talks that much about being a good person is probably not. And people who are often self-loathing and say they're the monster are often people who are just struggling. But you don't want to get lost in playing the role of the monster, so much so that you become one permanently. And you don't want to become so lost in playing the facade of the good person that you end up just a preacher at a pulpit who behind closed doors isn't practicing what you preach. Be honest with yourself and where you're at. And understand that unless you're a content creator, you will never, ever understand what it is like to wake up to hundreds of messages a day telling you who you are. And I mean like a content creator who actually has an audience in which you would wake up every day to hundreds of messages. Because there are so many things that happen behind closed doors that I can't tell you because, you know, snitches get stitches. But girl, it is not a fantasy. It is a very human reality. And I love it. I hate it. I'm grateful for it. I resent it. I'm learning to live with it. I have made peace with it. Thank you for watching. Have the most fantastic day. I look so forward to your comments. Please like for the algorithm. If you're listening on Spotify, praise be to you. And if you guys have any passionate comments, those are the ones I love the most. Leave some passionate comments. Also, I offer one-on-one calls on Patreon. I love doing these calls. They are 100% my favorite thing about this job. If you guys ever want to talk to me, I'm available. I'm literally available. I always dreamed that a YouTuber would be available for me to pay for their time so we could talk about ideas. And like, that's what I do. I make it available to you. Please do not be nervous. Do not be shy. I will move you through the call. You'll be totally fine. But it is one of my favorite things I've ever done. I've learned so much from people over the years and vice versa. But if you feel like you're struggling, if you feel like you have an idea, you want to talk about things you don't want the internet to hear, our calls are completely private. I do not record them. And you're allowed to say things. It's a safe space to say the things you're feeling because I do think we're living in a world where even your therapist isn't allowed to hear you say things because then they'll have to get the law involved. And I think sometimes some of us need to say out loud, I want to die, but I don't want to die. Because I've been around people who say, I want to die. And the government says 5150 them. But if I had done that to them, it would have been way worse. And so I didn't. And I cared for them instead. And it was better. So I know that life outside of your head is chaotic. If I can help in some way make your life inside your head a little less chaotic, I would love to do that. If you think I'm that person to help you on that journey. If not, trust me, there are other people. And I know they're out there. And they're openly going to admit that they're not perfect. Because I don't know about you, but nothing pisses me off more than someone claiming that perfection is real. Because it has not been my life. It has not been the life I've seen around me. And it is so hard when you're a struggling teenager or a struggling adult with depression and suicide and panic attacks and anxiety and depression and a desire for BDSM or things that feel toxic but maybe aren't or maybe are or maybe... To have people in their small little bubbles try to explain to you you know, that life is simple when you're sitting here going, I don't know, dude, feels pretty complicated. So let me tell you right now, I do believe that the simple part of existence is our desire to love and be loved. Marilyn Manson, I guarantee you, same as Corpse, wants to love and be loved. And for some of us, if we're like on the Corpse end of the spectrum, we still have that ability. For on the Marilyn Manson, it's going to be a lot harder to get there, but I still think possible because I believe redemption is possible for most people. Thanks for watching, guys. I really appreciate it. I see you. I hear you. I look forward to hearing from you.
Stuck in my head, in real life I'm in bed. My belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine. Not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth and living life as a fool. Dun.